Amen. Give him a praise. Amen. Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Yes. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen. By faith. Amen. I'm glad that I'm a person who live by faith and not by sight. Can you shout amen? Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Thank God. Thank God for him being our God. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Whew. That's prophetic stuff, isn't it? I don't know if y'all getting this thing, but God is talking to us and telling us to open up our mouth and say what he say. I don't know if y'all getting that. Can you shout amen? You got to start saying what God say. Can you shout amen? Even in your praise and worship, you got to start saying what God say. Forget about your current circumstances and start saying what God say. Can you shout amen? You live by faith and not by sight. If you're going to experience life with God, you got to do it by faith. Can you shout amen? Amen. If you're going to experience life with God, you got to do it by faith. Hallelujah. If you're going to experience life with God, you got to do it by faith. Can't do it by feelings. Can't do it by sight. You got to do it just because you trust God. Am I talking to anybody in here? Amen. Amen. I said, am I talking to anybody in here? I'm going to get into the word of God tonight. I just want to let you see something. I'm going to get into the scripture tonight. I want to let you see God's point of view. This is not Bishop's point of view. This is not a man's point of view. This is God's point of view. Say amen. People come to church and we come to the house of God. And I don't know why you come to church tonight. I don't know your purpose of coming. But my purpose of being in the house of God is so I can get God's point of view. Amen. My prayer is for you that you understand as a believer more and more each day. Can you shout amen? But I don't care how much I pray for you. If that's not your desire, it won't happen. Amen. I can pray for you and pray for you and people can pray for you. But if you don't desire to know God's will for your life, then you won't know it. You have to seek God's will. Even Jesus, God's son in the flesh, he had to say, not my will, but let thy will be done. Amen. Jesus had to honestly seek after God's will in order for him to accomplish it. Can you shout amen? He had to seek after God's will in order for him to accomplish it. He had to seek after God's will in order for him to accomplish it. And I said this, I was on, and you know what God has let me know? God already let me know, you know, even though all y'all is here, I ain't preaching to everybody because somebody going to have their own mindset. You come into church because you think it's your duty. You're going to be paying attention to some other stuff, but I'm glad you're here. I'm glad you came to church tonight. Amen. Amen. But I know God has not given me this word for naught. But I know somebody wants to fulfill God's will in their lives. Amen. And so how many know, even though you are saved, God has a plan for you and I to fulfill his will. And you and I have to seek after God. If you don't seek God, seek after God, you will not ever fulfill God's will in your life. Can you say amen? Amen. Those are principles from the scripture. Those are principles that you and I as believers, we got to apply these things. You know, I was sitting down before I came to church tonight. I was sitting down looking at something I don't hardly do. I really don't, because I don't like to look at these talk shows and Steve Harvey and them, these people. I don't like to look at them shows. I don't, because they are so far off from God. I know some of you believers do, but I'd rather read my Bible and get my viewpoint. That's just me. Sister Banks, she's here. She know when I'm sitting out looking at television, if I ain't looking at sports, I'm looking at TBN. And that's it. And you know, that's just my preference. I used to look at the news. I don't like to look at that anymore. That's bad. Everything bad. Amen. It's just not conducive to God's way of living. And as a believer, you as a believer, let me tell you something. If you save now, but you save, you've accepted Jesus. But if you're going to experience God's way of living, you got to do it like he told you to do it. Amen. You got to be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Watch the verse. Look at 12, Romans 12, 2. And be not conformed to this world. What did conform mean? Yeah, I'm in the world. That's where all my thinking comes from. I don't take God's scripture. I don't love the word of God enough. I just take from. Watch this. Be not conformed to this what? World. Be not conformed to the what? World. What's the world? The lust of your flesh. The lust of your eyes and your pride of life. Okay? You can't even listen to your own self. Now that makes sense? You can't listen at you. Because me and you can't even think like God. Don't be conformed to this world. Don't listen at your own flesh. Don't listen at your own mindset. Don't listen at how you feel. You better get in the Word. You're not going to experience God's life by listening at yourself, by listening to other people, popular opinion. You can't experience God's way. Listen, feeling good doesn't mean that you're experiencing God's life. You got a lot of people feel good. I mean, no, you can go get high and feel good. Yeah. You might be stupid, but you'll feel good. And you got so many believers. Watch me now, listen. You got so many believers coming to church, they want to feel good. If I don't feel good, then, you know, God wasn't here. You know, man, sometimes you come to church, sometimes God's word going to conquer out there, and you don't need to feel good. Amen. And I'm not saying that we should be sad Christians and dying and out of, no, I'm talking about sometimes some of this stuff ought to make me and you think. And not talking about I'm feeling good all the time. Say amen. We cannot live by how we feel. We can't live by how we feel, peoples of God. You can't live by how you feel. You can't live by how you think. And now, hopefully, I'm getting into these parts of the scripture tonight. And we want to get into the word of God. And then we want God to reveal himself through the word, through his word. And we're going to look from some scripture that God himself gave us for a format to teach us about how he thinks. Okay? Now, you got to understand this. The Bible is how God thinks. That's what the scripture is. Amen. Now, you're going to get a lot of thoughts and a lot of birds flying over your head, dropping little stuff, but you don't let it build no nest up there. Say amen. You're gonna get a lot of thought patterns. You're gonna how you feel and somebody popular opinion on and my opinion and all of this, man. Listen, if we are going to experience the God kind of life, the way we experience the God kind of life as a believer is only through his word. Through his word, through his viewpoint. Amen. I can't understand for the life of me how people think they're gonna be prosperous when they can't pay their tithe. Stop asking for prosperity if you ain't tithing. Just go on and take your money and pay your bills and just be satisfied with not enough or just enough or whatever you're doing. Got quiet in there. That's my problem. My problem is with believers. How in the world you think we just come to church and take all of this time to study out God's way of doing things? I'm talking about God. He's alive and he's a living God. He saved us. Now, he wants us to live out this life so that he can get glory out of our life by us trusting in him. And then you got saved. They get weary and they take that, you got weary. And then so now my business got behind and this done happened. So you don't tithe. When you don't tithe, you don't honor God. You don't honor God in your finances when you don't tithe. Now watch me. You can experience, listen to what I'm about to say, because I'm going right back into our teaching. Worshiping God out of relationship. Don't let nobody cause you to miss what I'm teaching now. This is the most valuable lesson you ever going to hear in your life as a believer. There's no other message, and all the word of God is right. All the word of God is truth. All the word of God is encouraging. But the message that we're talking about now, and the message that we're talking about, there's no other message that's going to be more valuable to you in your Christian walk until you learn how to worship God out of that relationship that you have. You don't worship God out of duty. You worship God out of relationship. That's why so many people get discouraged, because you're trying to worship God out of duty. Well, I'm supposed to do this. I got to come to church. I'm going to do this. I got to do this. You know, if I don't do this, I got to do this. You're going to get weary. But if you're doing it out of relationship, you don't care what nobody say. You know why you're doing it. You're doing it out of relationship, because you have a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, and you're worshiping him out of relationship. Can you shout amen? All right. So you learn how to worship God out of a relationship. Okay? So now, if I'm going to pay my tithe, watch me now. If I'm a tither and I'm going to pay my tithe, I'm believing God, why? Let me tell you something. Get this out your mind. I'm trying to help you here. I don't pay my tithe so God can give me something. I tithe because I honor him. That's why. He ain't got to give me nothing. He done gave me everything. Everything you have belongs to him. What you tell me? So I'm going to get my tithe. He's going to give me something. Wrong mindset. He required the tithe for one purpose. You're going to see this. He required the tithe for one purpose, because he wants to know that you honor him. That's why. He wants to know that you honor him. That's it. He wants to know if you honor him. Okay. Now, that's what he told the children of Israel. You don't honor me. Because now, he said, you don't even tithe to me. You don't honor me. And so many people, sometimes we hear the message, and everybody coming to church, don't give to get. You don't give to get. You give because you honor him. Somebody texted me a message today. I had talked to him, and they texted me on the message and said, God has been so good to me. Oh, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. God has been so good to me. If I ask everybody here a question, I say, has God been good to you? What you gonna say? You know what my response? I didn't text him back. I normally text him back a message, but I didn't text him back, because they probably not want to hear what I had to say. So I didn't text him back. Not today anyway, but I will text him back. You know what I said? I said, sure, God, you're gonna say God done been good to you, but how good have you been to him? It's amazing to me how we want God. We just want God to just bless us. We just want God to bless us and to open doors for us. That's why we serve God. You know, that's why some people come to church, because they want God to do this and want God to do that. Want God to do this and want God to, ooh, open, bless me, Jesus. Bless me. Bless me, bless me, bless me. Bless me, bless. What are you doing for him? Are you witnessing to anybody? Are you strengthening his church? What are you doing for him? If I cut the service off right now and I call every one of you up here one by one, I wonder, can you tell me what you're doing for him? No, not what the church is doing for him, not what bishop is doing for him. No, what are you doing for him? I wonder if you can tell me that. I told her to be honest with y'all, and I shared my feeling last night. I could hardly go to sleep again. I got frustrated again. You said, Bishop, you must be one of the most frustrated preachers in there. But this season time of my life, I'm just getting frustrated. Because, you know, saints think, I don't know what believers are thinking. We won't read the Bible. We won't trust the scripture. We come to church with all these ideologies, all these ideals, and we won't come to church and listen at God's way of doing things. And then when things ain't working out the way we think they should be working out, then we get our own mindset on what we're going to do, on how we're going to do it, and da, da, da. And then we put, what are we going to do, and what am I going to do? And then we put it in Jesus' name. Simply because you back the statement up in Jesus' name don't mean God behind it. Amen. I heard a lot of them saying to him, doing all this crazy stuff to him, in Jesus' name. You can't put Jesus' name on everything. Amen. Because his name is only going to, you're only going to find authority in his name when we do things the way God said do them. Amen. And that's when we're going to find, authority in the name of Jesus. Can you say amen? I know you ain't going to give me amen. I'm going to preach to the people that I'm assigned to. Okay. I'm supposed to be assigned to all y'all, but some of y'all ain't going to listen, but I'm glad you're in church tonight. I'm glad you're here. But go to sleep as you want to. But I'm glad you're here. And I know that God, this assignment is for people. It's for people that really wants to fulfill God's will in their lives. Amen? So now if you're going to try, listen at this. If we as believers are going to accomplish the will of God in our lives, this is how important this is. You better learn how to worship God out of relationship, not based on how people like you, not based on how people think about you. You better learn how to worship God out of a relationship. If you don't learn how to worship God out of relationship, a whole bunch of stuff going to get on your mind. You're going to be oppressed and depressed about a whole lot of things. Say amen. I know y'all wonder how I keep my peace. I'm going to keep my peace because I got a relationship. I talk to God when I can't talk to nobody else. I'm talking to him. Hey, I don't talk to nobody more than I talk to him. I don't talk to nobody more than I talk to God. I don't talk to Sister Bank more than I talk to God. I don't talk to nobody on the earth more than I talk to God. I want that to sink in right there. You got so many people, they get on the telephone, they talk with people for hours. Boom, boom, boom. All on the phone, stay on the phone. Ain't talking about nothing, just on the phone. They talk for people. Talk with people for hours. And then God can't get 15, 20, 30 minutes of time in prayer. Isn't that something? War room. That's what you call it? In the book of Numbers, let's get into the scripture, please. Numbers, let's go back to the 15th chapter. I didn't bring my glasses. Let me have your glasses. I can't do yours. You got to go get some? All right. 15th chapter in the book of Numbers. Reading glasses, are they? Okay, they ain't got no prescription. Y'all probably need to read some too. Okay. Sister says she got some excellent. Come on back. Yeah, them reading glasses right there. Yes, them reading glasses right there. Amen. All right. Now, let's do the lesson tonight. Okay, now, in the lesson, now I want you to pay attention. Like I said now, and I know I'm assigned, I know my assignment that God has given me to teach this message. Let me say it like this. It is for everybody. It is for all the believers, especially the believers that I'm pastoring. But everybody is not going to receive from this assignment. No. And I read a sign. I read a sign, and it's a really, really good quote. It's a really good quote. Destiny is not by chance. It's by choice. I'm going to say it again. Destiny ain't by chance. It's about the choices that you make. You don't walk into your destiny by chance. Oops, I'm over. Well, that's a mistake. Destiny is not by chance. Destiny is by choice. And the choices that we make sometimes can hinder us from our destiny. Amen. Okay. Let's start from the 14th chapter. What's that? Thank you. Okay, in our lesson text tonight, so I'm going to be reading now, and I want you to kind of, you got to get your Bible now. You got to read. You got to read. I'm going to kind of be reading something, because I got some stuff I want to pull up out of here, and I want to show you. This is, remember, this is God's perspective. So let's get into the lesson, okay? All right. Let's do the 13th chapter, 25th verse. Okay, I'm going to be moving rapidly, okay? The 25th verse. After exploring the land for 40 days, the men returned to Moses and Aaron and the whole community of Israel at Kadesh in the wilderness of Paran. They reported to the whole community what they had seen and showed them the fruit they had taken from the land. This was their report to Moses. We entered the land you sent us to explore, and it is indeed a bountiful country, a land flowing with milk and honey. Here is the fruit it produces, 28th verse. But the people living there are powerful, and their towns are large and fortified. We even saw giants there, the descendants of Enoch, 29. The Amalekites live in the Negev. The Hittites, the Jebusites, the Amorites live in the hill country. The Canaanites live along the coast of the Mediterranean Sea and along the Jordan Valley. 30th verse. But Caleb tried to quiet the people as they stood before Moses. Okay? Caleb tried to quiet the people as they stood before Moses. And he said, let us go up at once and take the land, he said. We can suddenly conquer it. Okay? We can suddenly conquer it. Now, let me have your attention for a minute. Now, this is the promised land that God had promised Israel. Israel at this time, the Jewish nation, this was the nation that God had chosen to reside in, okay? God was going to use the nation of Israel to speak to the whole world. So he chose them so that he can live amongst these people and so that he can through these people, he can call all the other nation to know that he's God. That's why he didn't choose the biggest nation. He didn't choose the greatest nation. He didn't choose the most popular nation. He chose the Jewish. The Jewish nation started from one man, Abraham. And God chose him and said, in Abraham, now what? And Abraham and Sarah, his wife, she couldn't have no kids. But God chose him, and God says, through Abraham and Sarah, I'm going to raise up a nation. I'm going to call them the Jews. And in this nation, I'm going to live in it. I'm going to be their God, and they're going to be my people. Okay? All right. Okay. So now, this God's plan. That's how God was going to speak to the nation. So what did God do? He called Abraham. He spoke to Abraham and told him before Abraham had one kid. You know the story. He told him, he said, you're going to be the father of many nations. So your seed is going to be like the sands of the seashore for numbers. The boy ain't got a baby. His wife is what's the word? She's barren. And God promised him that he's going to make it him a mighty nation. Okay? So we basically know the story. So God chose the Jewish people to live in there. So God raised Abraham up. Then Abraham, Isaac, and Isaac had Jacob, and then the 12 patriarchs. And this is where we are. Now, Moses and them, they were in Egypt. One of the Egypt at the time was the greatest nation on the earth. And so now God took the little people, there's about 72 of them, when Abraham, then it was Isaac, and then Jacob, and then God raised up them out in the wilderness. And God knew that a famine was coming. So what God did, he called Joseph, sent Joseph ahead of time. Now remember, his brothers is the one that thought what they did to him. See, and that's why Joseph is the one that made the statement, you meant it for evil, but God meant it for good. You tried to destroy me and take my life, but God allowed that to happen because he was sending me forth so that he could protect his people. See? So now God got a plan. How many know God got a plan? God has a plan. And whatever God say, God is able and capable enough to bring it into pass. And now Abraham and no guy was out in the wilderness and a famine was coming through the land. God sent Joseph ahead where his brothers didn't like him. See, that's why you can't worry about when people don't like you. Ain't nothing but a setup. I'm preaching better, y'all saying amen. His brothers didn't like him. His brothers was jealous of him. So his brothers plotted to try to kill him because he found favor with his father. Ain't that good? When you find favor with the father, you're going to heap up enemies. And people don't, why you don't like him? I just don't like him. They think they all that. And all you're doing is trying to love on the father. And so now they concord against him to sentence them. So they said the brothers got together because they were jealous of him. And so what they did was they said, well, we got to get rid of this cat. And so when they plotted, they were going to kill him. But one of the brothers stood up and said, no, don't kill him. This is our brother. Don't kill him. And he was trying to tell his other brother not to do that and don't do that. But they said, well, they ain't going to kill him then. So what they did was they bind him up and they threw him down in a hole and they took the garment, his coat that his daddy had gave him, and they put blood on it. They go back and tell his dad that some wild animal ate him up. But what happened, some Midianites came through and seen him in the hole and bought him for a price as a slave and took him to Egypt. That was God's plan. Amen. And so God sent him on to Egypt. And so God sent him to Egypt, and now a famine was about to come in the land. And now Joseph, the same brother that they didn't like and that they were jealous of and that they tried to kill him, the same brother now is going to make provision for them. That's good. Stop and think. I know y'all be quoting all these scriptures, but you don't believe nothing you say. God said he'll make your enemy be at peace with you. Thou preparest a table before me in the... And people don't know their enemies sometimes. Sometimes you think your enemy is out of the world. Man, ain't no more people out there. You know. I'm going to get to that too. Y'all pray that I don't preach long tonight. I got a lot to say. I'm frustrated with us at the church. It's sad how the devil just take our thinking and we just act like a bunch of crazy people. We ain't fighting against the devil. We fighting against one another. Isn't that something? Are you thinking here? And watch the scripture too. Watch the scripture. I would say, okay, so now God is setting the thing up. So now they went through all this, and now God raising up a deliverer. He raising up a deliverer. Now they don't start having all these babies in Egypt, and they're having so many babies. Watch this God doing. This God, they were multiplying, boy. They were multiplying. Man, and what that boy named? Pharaoh? Pharaoh said, my God, these people, they gonna outnumber us after a while. We need to do something about this. Though we're going to have these people in the midst of us, and they're going to be greater than we are. So he decided that he's going to kill all the boy babies. We've got to stop this stuff. Okay? And thank God that God got God-fearing people around. They won't compromise with anything. Are you hearing? I'm glad that the midwives, there was women of God, the midwives said, we ain't killing them each other. We more scared of God than we are Pharaoh. And then they come to, they find out that the midwife wasn't killing the baby. They come to him and say, then you had strict orders to kill the baby? And you know what the midwife said? Said, man, we try to kill her, but they pop out so fast before we kill them. I don't know if they pop out that fast. The midwives just fear God. And so now, you know the story. So now they're going to multiply. And so God raised up a deliverer right in the midst of the enemy. And right in the midst of when they were slaves and triumph, God raised up Moses. And so now when God raised up Moses to be a deliverer for the children of Israel, God had a set time that he was going to bring them out. How many know God got a set time for you? You just got to wait on it. Hallelujah. I said God got a set time for you. You just got to wait on it. I'm going to say it again. I said God got a set time for you. How many of y'all believe God? You come on. You believe God for your life? Do you believe God got a set time that he going to bring you out of whatever you're dealing with? So all you need to do is what? Wait on him. It might be tough where you're waiting at, but wait on him. God got a set time that he's going to bring you out. And when he bring you out, you're going to have way more than what you had when you went in. I'm telling you, sometimes you don't know how God is restoring you like when you're going through. I'm telling you right now, if you waiting on God, God is already making ways for you. Watch me now. Ways that you don't even see. Ways that you don't know nothing about, God is making a way. Israel was in slavery, but God was raising up a deliverer right amongst them. God was raising up a deliverer right amongst them. That's why I trust God, because God, I know, is making ways for me right now. It don't matter about the plots of the enemy. Many afflictions of the righteous. But I ain't worried about no afflictions. Many afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers us out of them all. If I wait on him, God, there's a set day that God is going to bring us out. And the text says, when they went out loaded. They went out healed. They was in bondage for 400 years. They stayed in bondage. And the text says, the self same day, God promised that he was going to bring them out. He raised up Moses and he brought them out. He raised up Moses, and Moses started doing all kind of miracles through the hands of Moses, through the hand of their leader. Moses started doing all kind of miracles. God said, go tell Pharaoh, I said, let my people go. Go tell Pharaoh, I said, if you don't let my people go, tell him all your blood is going to turn, all the water is going to turn into blood. Did it happen? Let me ask you a question. Did Israel see it? He said, now tell, and then Pharaoh said, yeah, I'm going to let him go. Yeah, I'm going to do it. And then God take the curse off it. And then Pharaoh said, who is that God? And then God come back and speak to Moses again. Said, go back and tell Pharaoh, I said, let my people go. Though he's going to be infested with frogs. He's going to be infested with lice. All your cattle is going to die. Amen. It's going to be dark. It's going to be so dark till you can't see. In Goshen, where Israel was, it was light. But in Egypt, that's amazing. Our God is amazing, isn't it? That all this in your Bible. And then the Bible said the last one, when Pharaoh And when Pharaoh spoke out of his mouth that he was going to kill Moses and kill, you know, the firstborn of Israel. And God said, the very same thing that you spoke out of your mouth is going to happen to you. And so all the firstborn of Egypt that night died. God gave Moses a plan, didn't he? Watch me now. I'm saying this for purpose. God gave Moses a plan. Who was his leader? Moses. God gave him a plan, didn't he? God said, Moses, take a lamb. Tell Israel to slit his throat. Drain the blood. Put it in hyssop. Drain the blood. And it said, take the blood, take some, and put it on the doorpost of the house. And then he said, because the death angel is coming through here. I'm getting ready to deliver y'all out. Say amen. When God get ready to deliver you out, hell can't stop it. Anybody that get in your way, God to take care of them. Can they shout amen? Man, amen. I wonder is anybody getting this? God is the one that's going to fight your battle. You ain't got to fight your battle. All you got to do is do what he told you to do. Man, that's why you got to learn how to worship God out of your relationship. Not out of circumstance and situation. You learn how to worship God out of your relationship. Let whatever happen, let it happen. God, I still bless you. Amen. Whatever happened, let it happen. I still trust you. It's looking ugly, but I still trust you. It's looking bad, but I still trust you. Because you told me that you're going to deliver us. Amen. And so God raised Moses up and spoke to him. So he was going to deliver Israel out. And then he promised him, I'm going to bring you out of Egypt. Then I'm going to take you to a land, a promised land that flows with milk and honey. Say amen. How many in here don't receive some promises from God? Come on. For real, you know that those are promises from God. On Sunday, man, what you talking about? Man, I saw, you know, when we got to that part and the Holy Spirit came up in here and we started praying for our bodies. I felt that thing. Boy, I'm telling y'all, boy, I felt that thing. The next day I felt like going working out. Boy, I worked out so bad till I hurt myself. God, I said, boy, I felt good. Amen. Because you know you can lay hands on your body and God will prevent sickness from coming. You ain't got to wait till you get sick and get healed. You can pray now until healing can't, sickness can't touch you. Matter of fact, you ought to be thanking God for healing you. Don't wait till you get sick to thank him. Thank him for keeping you. I thank you for keeping me healed. Can this out? Amen. Let's do it one more time. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Come on. And all that would do. Come on, you got to pray for yourself. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all. Something happening in my head, I rebuke it in Jesus' name. Something happening in my throat, I rebuke it. Something happening in my lungs, my liver, or whatever, I rebuke it. I call my intestine to get right. Whatever is on the inside, cutting up, I don't know nothing about it, I command it in Jesus' name. Get right. Blood, get right. Heart, get right. And you tell my mom, I got a double beat in my heart. You might as well straighten up, heart. Amen. Amen. That's God's promise to us. That's the will of God for our life. Now that you got to experience the God kind of life. I'm in this world, but I'm not of this world. Can they shout amen? Come on, you got to know that you're a citizen of another kingdom. And I don't operate in this kingdom like they operate in the world. Can they shout amen? I call those things that be now. I think I'm in an excited church. Shoot, man. Oh, man. Hallelujah. So now we got to the point where they didn't come out. Remember they brought them out of, when God brought them out of Israel, remember they opened up the Red Sea. Remember God opened up the Red Sea. You remember the story, don't you? He opened up the Red Sea for the children of Israel. And when they came out, remember God called one man, Abraham, and now it's over 2 million of them. How many, God is not a man that he should, not the son of man that he has to change his mind. But if God said something, you know all them people, they got raised up when they were in slavery. When they were in bondage, God abundantly blessed them. And God was blessing, watch this, people of God. And God blessed the Egyptian nation because Israel was there. You ain't get that. You know God will bless things all around you because he's getting ready to bless you. You don't know when that stuff going to be turned over. The wealth of the wicked is laid up. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying. I quote that scripture in the right place that time. Kidney, actually, some people be quoting on the wrong place, but that was right on time right there. Are you hearing what I'm saying? God was, the wealth of the wicked was laid up for the righteous. Do you not know why they were slaves? God was allowing the wicked to get wealth because it was laid up for the righteous. Amen. And when God delivered them out of there, he said, go and tell all Egypt, give me the gold. Go to their house and tell them, give me your gold earring. Give me your gold necklace. Give me all your gold. And you know what them Egyptians would say? Y'all get it, but get out of here. God will mess people up so bad, tell them they won't like it, but they can't do nothing about it. They ain't like it, but they got to respect it because they know God will get them. Can this out? Hallelujah. You got to stop going in and trying to fight your own battle. Let God fight your battle. So he brings them out. Here they are. He brings them through the Red Sea. He brings them through the Red Sea. And they stood there, 2 million of them, saw the Red Sea open up and divided. Amen. And they walked across on dry land. Now look at the 13th chapter. And then it says 27th verse. Let's do the 30th verse. Go down to the 30th, where we were. Now God done promised them. Now remember, this is God's word. God promised them that he was going to bring them to the promised land, didn't he? Okay. Caleb tried to quiet the people before Moses and said, let us go up at once, and the land belongs to us. We can suddenly conquer it 31. But the other men who had explored the land with him disagreed. Let me ask you a question. What did they disagree on? What did they disagree about? The other 10 spies, they disagreed with Caleb. And further down in the scripture, it's going to say Caleb and Joshua. But right here, it just says Caleb. I got a good one for you when I get further down. How many know God needs some? I give it to you right now. How many know God needs some Calebs? And watch this. While I was studying the lesson, I said, God needs some Calebs, and he needs some Calibras. Because your women can't be called Caleb. Y'all Calibras. I borrowed your name tonight. That's where her name come from, Caleb. Oh, I know y'all didn't know that. Huh? I forgot. I wouldn't think about it either. I don't know why the Holy Ghost put it on my mind. Go and turn to a daughter and say, hey, Calibra. Now, you either a Caleb or a Calibra, or you the one of them 10 that bring back negative reports. You got people that they sit around the church and they don't have nothing but negative things to say. All right, I'm gone. Am I blessing you tonight? Yeah. Don't be looking at your clock then. Okay. But the other men who had explored the land with him disagreed. Well, I'm going to tell y'all something. Thank God for the Calebs and the Calibras. You ain't got too many Calebs and Calibras. Notice it were two of them. Caleb was the only one stood up. He stood up with Moses. Because Moses had, the leader, Moses, told them to go check the land out and say, this is the land. Now watch me now. This is the land that God promised us that we're going to have. Let me ask you a question. Did God fulfill the rest of what he told them? They saw it, didn't they? And now God said, now, but this is the land that you got. They went through all, they saw God's hand. They saw the miracles of God. Moses spoke to them. When they obeyed it, the mighty power of God rested on them. Nobody couldn't conquer them because the promise of God was over them. And you know this text? I was reading one theologian. He was saying, you know what the text says? That at nighttime, God led them with a pillar of fire. I don't believe it was just like a little master in fire. You know, somebody with a little fire master. I believe it was a blazing fire out in front. They were in the desert where wild animal was in domain. If God hadn't been with them people, they would have got swallowed up by the land. If you're going to read the scripture, they would have got swallowed up by the land. It was desert place out there. And God told them to go to the desert. But God led them by fire at night. Don't you know? It wasn't just no little blaze of fire. It was a big blaze of fire. So it'll run all the wild animals away. It'll run all the enemies away. They set up camp at night. And when they set up camp, they put up their tent and they went to sleep. And the fire blazed all night. Y'all ain't. All right, let me go. My, our God is an awesome God. But y'all can talk what y'all want. But I'm going to get myself in this word. I'm going to believe what God said. I ain't going to be all caught up in this world and all caught up with everybody's situation. I'm going to believe. I'm going to live out of my relationship. And I'm going to believe what God said about me. When this world is going to hell in a handbasket, I declare that my life is going to be blessed. I'm going to have a word from God. I'm going to have my peace. The joy of the Lord is going to be with me. If nobody else don't fuck up, I'm going to walk in this thing. Because it's God before you. All right, let's move. Let's move. Am I going fast enough? Okay. All right. 31st verse. They come down, the 31st verse. But the other men who had explored the land with him disagreed. We can't go up against them. They are stronger than we are. So they spread this bad report. They did what? Spread this bad report about the land amongst the Israelites. The land we traveled through and explored will devour everyone who goes to live there. All the people we saw is huge. We even saw the giants there, the descendant of Anak. Next to them, we felt like grasshoppers. See, when you don't believe God, you always look like a peasant. When you don't believe God, you always look like you're inferior. When you don't live out your relationship, you always look like you can't do it. When you ain't living out your relationship, you're always feeling like you can't, you ain't worth it. I can't do this. I can't do that. We look like grasshopper next to them. And that's what they thought too. How do you know what them people thought? Listen to these, and that's what they thought too. They thought we looked like grasshoppers in their sight. How they know what them people thought? And the text even tell us that the Canaanites and all them Ikes, they had heard about how God delivered his people across the Red Sea. And they were scared. Look what kind of report they brought back. They brought, watch me now. Who told them that the land was theirs? Talk to me. Who told them? Who told them that this is the promised land, that I'm gonna put you in it, this land belongs to you? Who told them that? So who they talking against? They think they're talking against the leader. When you start keeping up all kind of stuff in church, you ain't talking against the leader. You talking against God. God is the one that promised us that. Let me tell you something. And out there in the wilderness, it wasn't no pleasant situation. They had to have some encounters. They went through some tough things. People think when you're doing the will of God, you ain't got to deal with nothing. You got to deal with stuff, people. But what are you thinking about? You got to deal with situations. Simply because God done bless you and God told you to put you in a place, you think you just going to ride off in the white horses? You got to deal with stuff. Israelite, they had to deal. They got out in the wilderness, watched it. And sometimes God allowed you to deal with some situation to see if you're going to trust him or not. Not that he ain't going to bring you out, because he already told you that. He wanted to see if Israel were going to trust him. And what did they do? Just like he thought. They started talking against him. We're not able to do it. God said the land was yours. Didn't he? But time the situation looked bad, look what they started saying. Because they wasn't worshiping out of relationship. Hallelujah. They wasn't worshiping out of relationship. Sometimes people just be, you out here, you just doing things cause of duty. You ain't worshiping out of relationship. That's why when hell break loose, that's why you be the first one to spreading bad report. Let's read. Where we at? 14th chapter? Watch this. 14th verse. 14th chapter, first verse. Anybody getting anything? Anybody getting anything? But the whole community began weeping aloud. The whole community, then it got everybody in this uproar. And they cried all night. These people crying when? All night. Because of this bad report that these leading people in the church done spread it out the camp. It's over 2 million people. That's why I be telling y'all, not paying attention to the pulpit, listening to everybody out there. You don't listen to people out there. They ain't no leader. That's why you come to church and sit and hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Not what pew people's talking about. They don't even know what they're doing themselves, just running their mouth. Phew, let me slow down. I'm tired. Y'all people something else. I know we're going to talk about Israel, but I'm going to tell you something. We just like these people. I'm going to show y'all too. And I believe the reason why God wanted to show us is because God wanted to get our attitude straight. It hurts my heart to see how crazy we are. Notice this. Notice the whole lesson. Sis, daughter, notice the whole lesson. The whole lesson. Who talked about the unsaved people? They did. Them Canaanites couldn't even touch them. The unsaved preacher crew ain't our biggest problem. The unsaved people ain't our biggest problem. The devil ain't our biggest problem. Who is their biggest problem? They sitting in the midst of a nation where God has said, I want to be in the midst of you. They are the holy people. The holy people. These holy people. Y'all hear what I'm saying? This the church. That's what I mean. This the church. This where God dwelled at amongst Israel. Where God dwell at today? God dwelling here amongst us. Please preach, Bishop. God dwelling here amongst us. Look at these people. Who is even about this disturbance? They keep up all the mess fighting against one another. All this ism and schism, they keeping it up. They're not even turning the hearts of people against the leader. Because it's right here in the church. We are our biggest enemy. Fighting against one another. Little knick-knack stuff. People can't even go back in the nursery and keep the children. Y'all back there fighting. And then you want to bring all that mess to me. Everything in the nursery is in the kitchen. Everything in the kitchen is on the women's bowl. The deacon bowls. Ain't nothing but flesh. It ain't unsaved people. It ain't the devil. It's us. We fight against one another, killing off one another. Divided in church where the presence of God is, and yet we are biggest enemies. Is that the text? They fighting against one another. These people, these men, they were leaders of the congregation. They were leaders. But they had a problem with Moses. That's why they brought back that bad report. Anytime you got folks sitting around that got a problem with your leader, watch them. Nobody got time for that foolishness. Say amen. Nobody got time for that. Either this work is of God or not of God. Amen. 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 And every work that God has ever raised up, you better believe that the enemy done tried to destroy it. and you got fight. I don't care where you at, where you go, you got fights in the midst of the church. And the only reason why the church stay together, because they understand, well, okay, we got to love one another and forgive one another. I ain't done. I want you to see the scripture. Now, because of these leaders, and you had two of them to stand up and say, hey, hey, hey. Now, let me ask you a question. Let me ask you a question. Come here, come here, come here. Let me ask you. He sent the 12 spies out, right? 12 of them, right? Let me ask you. Did all of them go to the same place? Did all of them see the same thing? Huh? Did everybody see the same thing? When y'all come to church, do you hear the same thing? Do you see the same thing? Let me ask you a question. Do I see what you see? I bet you I see a little bit more of you. All of us are in the same thing. We see it. But who gonna believe God? Who gonna believe the report of the Lord? Who gonna believe the report of the Lord? What God said. God said, I'm gonna be in the midst of you, and whatever you gotta deal with, I'm gonna bring you through it. Hey, let me tell y'all something, man. You know where God dwell at? Watch me now. Listen at the revelation. Listen. You know where God dwell at? God chose the church, the body of believers. The church is all over the world, right? And God chose the church to dwell in. He ain't in the White House. The church got to pray for the White House. He not on the House of Representatives. He not in there. No. He ain't with the Black Panthers. You know where he at? In the church. He chose to dwell in the church. And he says to us, he says, when y'all come together and y'all glorify me, I promise you I'll be in the midst of you. He said, when y'all come together, see, look at believer. Look at our church. Most of our church don't believe it. Look at it. Everybody come to church on Sunday, Tuesday night, don't know where they at. Now, you know I love folk. You know, I'm just trying to show you our mentality. That's our mentality. We don't thank God in the midst of us. If we thought God was in the midst of us, we wouldn't miss no days. I don't care if I had church, I don't care if we had church 3 times a week. If we thought God was in the midst of us, you wouldn't tell them, folks, I'm getting on my job. I got to go to church. I got to meet God. But we don't think like that. Because we don't understand theology. We don't understand God's mindset. Whew, slow down again, I'm tired. Again. Okay. What verse I stopped in? Y'all just hear me ranting and rave. I want y'all to get the scripture. Because I'm sure frustrated. I am. And you know I'm going to love you to death. But I'm so frustrated with us. It's sad for us to sit up in here and just let the devil do anything he wants. And then we don't have enough mature people that really do love God to know how to say that's flesh. We ain't even deal with that. People raise people up in the midst of it and say that's flesh. Let's deal with that and let's move on. This is the house of God. This is where God chose to have his presence. And then in the presence of God, and I want you to see it, in the presence of God, all these people just run their mouth. You got people, they don't respect God's presence. They say anything, be doing anything right in here. Can't work together. Can't put a table together. I don't want this cloth. Put the red cloth on. No, the green one, the blue one. I am mad. Oh. Ain't coming because of green. And then y'all want to call me up all in the midst of that foolishness. You fight about a green. That's letting me know how immature you are. I don't care if the tablecloth was red, white, and purple. We ain't got enough in our spirit to just walk in unity. Okay, I made a decision last year. Okay, y'all can make a decision this year. Oh, we did this. So okay, whatever you think. All right, let's do it. Let's have.
Well, you know.
You know how it's always have a flesh. cannot submit ourselves and humble ourselves so that because we know that the presence of God is in the midst. The presence of God is on the presence of God is in the midst of us. I deal with a lot of stuff because I know the presence of God is in the midst of us. Okay, slow down, Banks. Eighth verse. Nope, what verse? Second verse. Their voices rose up in a great chorus and protest against Moses and Aaron. They protest against who? Moses and Aaron. Who they protest against? The leaders. Who they protest against? I don't know why Bishop doing all that. Don't make me come down there, y'all. All people need is an opportunity. Sometimes to say what's in their hearts. And they ain't got enough to examine their hearts before they get in the midst of people. Thoughts gonna come in everybody's mind. You got to be a mature person to know if that thought come from God or if it came from flesh or Satan. Say, I ain't gonna even. I tell my flesh, you ain't gonna even say that. You must be out your mind. I'm telling you, I tell my flesh, you ain't gonna say this to nobody. So you might as well just take your little crazy looking self and sit down. We want to tell everybody else what to say, but you can't tell your own self what to say. How you think you're going to operate in dominion when you can't tell your flesh what to do? You want to tell everybody else's flesh what to do, but your flesh louder than everybody else you're trying to tell. And then you know what people want me to do? Then people want me to trust them making decisions. Do I got stupid on my head? You want me to trust you to make a decision in God's house? Why, bitch, you wouldn't let me leave? Why, bitch, you wouldn't let me do that? Why, bitch, you wouldn't? You are messed up in the back. I know what you would do in the front. Let me tell you something. I ain't trying to be deep. I ain't trying to be no like I'm discerning till I know all y'all spirit. I just do what the scripture tell me. Watch and pray. Okay, that's all I can do. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Every time I see you out in the parking lot cutting the food, I'll be a stupid pastor to be putting you up over people. Then you want to be deep, talking about, I know I'm anointed. I'm, they can't even pray. I can pray better than that. Nobody want to hear you pray. People want you to walk in humility. You got to be mature enough to keep peace in the house of God, to keep peace among the church, to keep peace. Don't be bringing up all that craziness among the church. If I see myself as a person in confusion, I repent right now. God is not the author of confusion. You think I look like I got a big old stupid stamp on my head. I would rather go around and say, you do this, you do this, you do this, you do this, than to turn loose the work of God to a bunch of fleshy people. Because if I turn loose the work of God to a bunch of fleshy people, they're going to call problems on me. I'm going to have to rebuke you. You're going to get mad at me. I'm going to have to get these people. People are going to be offended. I got to take them in the office and counsel them to death. And I got to be out here 3-4 hours while you go home with your big mouth self. Guess you think I'm stupid, though. I'm just. You got more sense than me. I guess God thought I had a little sense. Well, yeah, he made me the leader, didn't he? And I probably had no sense, but he knew that I was going to do things like he wanted me to do them. That's all that is. Amen. Yeah, yeah, y'all probably smarter than me, but I got enough sense to do. I do this thing like God told me to do it. And I ain't going to let nobody come out here and try to dictate me. I ain't finna be listening. I love y'all to death. I love you to death, but you get enough word to know how to grow up and be mature. Nobody going to be sitting out here babysitting you. You mad about the napkins? I'm finna go. I bought all these black napkins. They ain't you now. What time is it? Thank God for the Calebs. Hallelujah. Thank God for the Calibras. Hallelujah. Thank God for these people. These people, thank God for the Joshua and the Josephs. That's the lady name for Joshua. Mm-hmm. Thank God for the Calebs and the Joshuas and the Calibras and the Josephs. That they gonna believe God no matter what. They understand that trouble gonna come, but they still believe God. They ain't gonna allow nobody to come in this house and talk against their leader. Listen at this. Watch this. Look at this right here. Look at this right here. Look at this. It says, their voices rose in a great chorus and protest against Moses and Aaron. Now I'm gonna tell you something. What did Moses do? What Aaron did? All they did was say what God said. Come on, let me ask you a question. Come here. Who were they fighting against? Thank you. Who were they fighting against? And you be thinking you be fighting against me or you fighting against Sister Banks and all that. None of us are perfect. You think you fighting against, but you fighting against God. Okay. So, watch what they says. If only we had died in Egypt. If only we had died in Egypt. Look at the people. Then they kept up so much confusion. What did these carnal folk? Watch this now. We wish we had died in Egypt. What they wanted to do? They wanted to turn back and go back to Egypt, where they were slaves at. After they done seen all the hand of God, now they're talking about, we wish we would have died in Egypt. In other words, they let us out here like this. They done saw all these miracles, all the power of God. Now, because of fleshly people, and they're talking against God, it caused people now that, oh, we might well go back to Egypt. Mm-hmm. Or even here in this wilderness. If only we had died in Egypt. Kill us. Or even here in this wilderness. We might well die, they complained. Why is the Lord taking us? Watch this now. They done saying it now. Why is who? The Lord taking us to this country only to have us die in battle? Otherwise, the Lord can't keep us. You know all that God done promised us. You know people start raising up and start keeping up confusion. You forget about that. You put that tithe out there because you believe in God for your abundance. Or you put that offering out there. Remember you walked up here and you said, boy, I heard a good word from the Lord. And the Lord spoke over my life. Here, Bishop, take this seed because I'm believing that my fruit's going to come up. But you forget about that when you let the enemy start talking in your head. You forget about the promise and the blessing of the Lord. And look what they said. Now, watch this. This is what I told you. Watch what you say out your mouth. Let me tell y'all something. If I haven't learned anything, I learned Watch what you say out your mouth. Anything is not coming out of my mouth. I don't care how mad I get. It can come up there how much you want. It ain't coming out of here. Are you hearing me? Sister Banks and I, we would get so angry at one another till we get so angry at one another. This is in our younger days. We get so angry at one another till we'd be around there fighting. But she ain't never heard me cuss her out. I've never cussed her out. I done said some other stuff, but I ain't never cussed her. You think I ain't want to cuss her? Come on. I said, you think I didn't want to cuss her? Let me tell you why I didn't cuss her. Because I was serving God out of relationship. And I knew it wasn't coming out my mouth. I call her stupid. I call her, but I ain't finna cuss her out. And then God got on me by calling her stupid. She, I won't do that now. Stop that. You can do crazy as you want. Ain't no calling stupid. I said, baby, you need to have a little bit more understanding than that. Because you can't let everything come out this mouth. If you I'm telling you something now, you be coming to church, and you got a lot of sick folk be coming around, can't get healed because they let everything come out of him. You around your house, you got to watch what you say out your mouth. Because your word go with you. You don't leave your words home, they come to church with you. Your word go to Alabama with you. Your words go wherever you go, they go on with you. Move out the project that you want, your words go on with you. Move into the suburb, your words going right with you. Watch what the children of Israel say. Listen what they said. Why the Lord taking us to this country only to have us to die in battle? Watch this. Our wives, they talking too much. Our little ones will be carried off as plunder. Wouldn't it be better for us to return to Egypt? Then they plotted among themselves. Watch this. God, priest, Bible, preach word. Then they plotted among themselves. Let us choose a new leader. And what the new leader gonna do? They're gonna take us back to Egypt. Let us choose. That's why God don't leave it up to people to choose leaders. God ain't left it up to you to choose your leader. Some of you all don't even know how you got him. God, I don't know how I got him. God, I know you thought because you met somebody and they met you and all that and you didn't win them and all that. God. Now, watch these people. Things ain't going like they want to go. We done went through some stuff. Oh, it's tired of him. I'm tired of him. We done went through some things. All right, I got to find me. Let's find us a new leader. I preach this because the scripture said it. Let me show you one thing that I'm confident in. One thing I'm confident in, I know who I am, and I know my position. And I ain't worried about all this. You know what? If I had no confidence, I wouldn't preach a message like this. It doesn't matter to me. If God raise you up and send you somewhere, get on. I bid you Godspeed. Because I know who I am, and I know what I'm going to do. I know I'm going to seek God. It don't matter to me. You understand what I'm telling you? I don't know why people think, listen at me. I'm not intimidated. I ain't scared about nobody. Okay, all right. If God called you to do something, then do it. Come on, let's talk about it so I can be at you Godspeed. Because what God has planned for you is for you. Let us choose us a new leader. God, talk it. Fifth verse. Then Moses and Aaron fell down on the ground before the whole community of Israel. Two of the men who had explored the land, watch this, Joshua, son of Nun, Josette, daughter of Nun, Caleb, son of Jephunneh, Calebras, daughters of Jephunneh, tore their clothes, See, that's what's happening. You know, you got a mature bunch of believers. People in here are going to believe God. And sometimes you hear stuff, crazy stuff happening around the church. It tears your heart. I mean, it tears your heart. That let me know that you are a Joshua, or you are Joseph, or you are Caleb, or you are Calibra. And you sitting around and you want God's will to be done. You know everything ain't going to go right, but you with the man of God. You with what God has ordained. You got to be with what God has ordained. It ain't about no flesh. It's about what God has ordained. I'm going to cut off a quarter till, okay? That's good. That want me cut off now? Ain't no cut off no way. I just play with y'all. I just playing. Okay. They tore their clothes and they said to all the people of Israel, the land we've traveled through and explored is a wonderful land. And if the Lord is pleased with us, He will bring us safely into that land and give it to us. It is a rich land flowing with milk and honey. How many know they quoting what God said? Boy, that's good, isn't it? Things is going crazy, but these people, these men, and these men, the Caleb and the Joshuas and the Calibras and the Josettes, they going to say what God say. They ain't going to get caught up in all that old crazy foolishness. Amen. Ninth verse. Do not rebel against the Lord and don't be afraid of the people of the land. They are only helpless prey to us. They cake for us. They have no protection. But the Lord is with us. Don't be afraid of them. But the whole community began to talk about stoning Caleb and Joshua. Nah, you want to stone the people? Uh-oh, that's a good one to preach at right there, Bishop. Now you want to stone the people that said, Bishop said. Now you want to stone them. You ain't come out to my, what Bishop say? What Bishop say? What Bishop say? What else they going to say? Man, now they want to kill. Now they only want, they want to get new leaders. They want to get rid of Moses and Aaron. And now, and because Caleb and Joshua start saying what Moses and Aaron said, now they say, we're going to get rid of y'all too. We're going to stone y'all. You're going to death. We ain't going to have y'all in the midst of us telling them what God said. We want to do what we want to do. That's what's the one with a lot of people in church. They want to do what they want to do, not what God has ordained. If I did what I wanted to do, I promise you I wouldn't be here. I promise you, if I wanted to do what I wanted to do, I promise you I wouldn't be here. I'd be somewhere else preaching. But I'd be getting way more money. I've had some really good offers. But I know that wasn't what God ordained me to do. I know that wasn't God called me to do. You telling me it wasn't good offers? Man, you finna put me up in my own house? You finna pay me? These people finna pay me. Tell me all I need to do, and all I need to do is just work in the ministry. But I know that wasn't God called me to do. Amen. Hey, it's not what I want, not what you want, it's what God's will is. Well, stop that. Y'all tired? Mm-hmm. I'm going to quit. I'm tired. Let me see where I want to end up at. Okay. Watch this. Yeah. Watch this. Let's read about what God said. Okay. The worst word. Fifth verse. Moses and Aaron, they sit down. Sixth verse. Two of the men who had explored the land, Joshua and Caleb, seventh verse. They said unto all the people, the land we traveled through and explored, eighth verse. And if the Lord is pleased with us, he will bring us safely into the land and give it to us. Ninth verse, do not rebel against the Lord and don't be afraid of the people of the land. They are only helpless. Pray for us, to us. They have no protection. Tenth verse, but the whole community began to talking about stoning Joshua and Caleb. Joshua, hey, I'm talking to the Joshuas now. Joshuas, don't worry about what people say about you. God has a destiny for you. You keep your eyes looking up on the leader and on God. The reason why Joshua and Caleb followed God so much because they trusted God's anointing. Not his flesh. They trusted what was on him. They trusted God called on him. There is no way a man can do what when God put his power in. There's no way a man can teach or to discern or have nothing, whatever God called him to do. No way he could have done what he can't do that in his own strength. No way Moses could have done what he did. Joshua understood because Joshua was listening at the voice of God. Let me tell you something. If you ever going to learn, listen at me. Come here. If you ever going to learn how to worship God out of your relationship, you got to listen at God's voice. Listen at what God say. Don't listen at what nobody else say. Listen at what God say. And listen at it with a pure heart. And get all them butts out your heart. Whatever God says is right. Amen. If you ever going to know how to worship out of a relationship, you got to listen to what God say. And that's Joshua. That's the Josephs. I thank God for him every day. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for the Calebs and the Calibras. Men and women that's going to believe God. Understand the protocol of God. Know that things ain't going to be easy all the time. We're going to go through some dilemmas. We're going to go through some trials and some hard times. People are going to go through situations. But God wants people that, regardless of what we go through, God wants to have some people that's going to trust him anyway. Hallelujah. They want to stone him. Love of earth, and the Lord said to Moses, how long, watch this. Y'all looking with me? How long will you with these people that treat me with contempt? This God talking. They're doing what? Treating God with contempt. Mm-hmm. They're totally dishonoring God. Would they never believe me? Even after all the miraculous signs I have done among them, they still don't believe me? This is that God crying out, isn't it? Watch this. God said, I'm going to disown them and destroy them with the plague. Said, then I will make you into a nation greater and mightier than they are. Listen to what God talking to Moses. I'm tired of these rebellious people. They ain't going to never believe me. After all I done did for them, they still don't trust me. You didn't look what God tell Moses. Come on, check this out, people. God tell Moses, say, I tell you what. I'm going to get rid of these hard-hearted people. They don't want to trust me. After all I done did for them, after all they done seen that I did through my leader, Moses, and they want to kill him. God said, I tell you what, I'm going to kill all of them. Isn't that something? He said, I kill all of them. Then I'm going to go get another nation. And this is what God said. I'm going to get another nation, and then, you know, I'm going to rest in that nation. Then I'm going to take you, Moses, and I'm going to give you some new people. The people that's going to honor me. And check out what Moses said. But Moses objected. What will the Egyptians think when they hear about it? He asked the Lord. They know full well the power you display in rescuing your people from Egypt. Now, if you destroy them, the Egyptians will send a report to the inhabitants of the land who have already heard that you live amongst your people. Isn't that good? They know, Lord. They know. that you have appeared to your people face to face, and that your pillar of cloud hovers over them. They know that you go before them in a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. Now, if you slaughter all these people with a single blow, the nation, they have heard of your fame, will say, the Lord was not able to bring them into the land he swore to give them. So he killed them all in the wilderness. Please, Lord, prove that your power is great as you have claimed. For you said the Lord is slow to anger and filled with unfailing love, forgiving every kind of sin and rebellion. He does not excuse the guilty. Now this part I play. He lays the sins of the parents upon the children. The entire family is afflicted, even children in the third and fourth generation. All right, I got to quit. I got so much to say in this, but I got to quit. This is it. Close the Bible. Done. And this is what Moses interceded for these people. Now, listen at me. These are the same people that wanted to stone Moses. Wanted to kill him. I'm going back into this thing, and we got to see God. We got to see God's perspective in the midst of this. These are the same people that wanted to kill Moses and Aaron. Now he has to intercede for them. Because God talking about giving a man a new nation. And what he do? He intercede for them. Please, Lord, don't kill him. I know they've been rebellious and sinful. He said, but you are loving God. He said, you forgive all kind of sin and rebellion. He said, what the other nation going to say? Let me tell you something. When you're living for God out of relationship, you don't want everybody to see you do crazy. Certain things you will do because of your relationship with God. Certain things you won't say because of your relationship with God. Certain ways you won't act because of your relationship with God. There is sometime in my flesh, I feel like I want to bust. I feel like I want to just bust. You ever felt like that? Just want to bust? But I don't care how the flesh feel, I refuse to let the flesh dictate my actions. Why? Because of my relationship. And so Moses, because he knew God, he says, the sins of these people is going to fall on their children. Now you got to hear what I'm about to say here now. And I'm done. He said, the sins of the people, he says, you are faithful God. He said, you forgive them. And then you're going to read farther down. And Moses said, because the sins of people have fallen on their children. From the third to the fourth generation. Watch how this play out. Then God, after Moses got through, then God said, I won't destroy them. He said, but I promise you this, they won't see the land that was theirs. They won't enter to the land. He said, those that are 20 years old and older, they're going to die in the wilderness. Now watch God. Watch God's judgment on them. They'll die in the wilderness. They won't see the land. Now, you know how far they were for the promised land? 21 days they could have been into the promised land. All that they saw, they could have conquered it in 21 days. 21 days they could have conquered the Canaanite, the Anite, all them giants that they saw. If they would have trusted God, they could have conquered them in 21 days. But because they didn't honor God, they didn't believe God, and they weren't under what God had set up, God said, I'll tell you what's going to happen. They ain't going to see it. Because of their dishonoring me, because they don't believe me, they won't see it. But then remember what they said out of their mouth? They said, have y'all brought us out here so our children can die? And God said, I heard them. He said, God said, I heard what you said. He said, your children ain't going to die. I'm going to keep your children and you going to die. But listen to how the sins of the parent passed down on the children. Them children had to stay out there 40 years because of them people unbelief. Then God speaks out of his mouth and said, you went over and you spied out the land for 40 days and 40 nights, didn't you? God talking. He said, you went over and you spied the land out. And you spied out for 40 days and 40 nights, didn't you? He said, because of your unbelief, you're going to stay in the wilderness a year for every night that you saw it and didn't believe me. And they stayed out in the wilderness and they died. And God kept the children that they said were going to be ate up by the beast. Listen at me, people of God. We got to cut the foolishness out. My conclusion. Listen at these folk. It wasn't the Canaanites. It ain't the Jebusites. It ain't none of them Ikes. Them enemies don't know what's happening in the midst of them. You know who's keeping up all the folk for? The church. Israel. They fighting amongst themselves. Now watch me now. And the enemy, he loves that. Because when we fight amongst ourselves, people ain't going to see the glory of God on us. Where the glory at? These are a bunch of fighting people. They talking about one another. Where the glory at? We don't need the devil. We don't need the devil to come and destroy us. Stop talking about Lord, the devil. It ain't the devil. We can't even get control of our own flesh. Let me ask y'all a question. Open up your eyes and see. Tell me who coming. Who coming here keeping up confusion? Is it unsaved people? Who is it? Us? We fighting against one another? We got to get up here and preach to my loved one, love one another. Hey, you find your brother fall against a sin. Please forgive him. No. You ain't worshiping God out of no relationship. That's why you can't forgive people. That's why you can't love on folk. That's why you can't humble yourself. Okay, everybody, we ain't going to agree. Everybody ain't going to love blue. Somebody got to be mature enough to say, go ahead and put the blue in the thing. Okay. And then get anointed and then get you a scripture. Blue is for the sky. Hallelujah. I didn't think of it, but blue is for the sky. Somebody else did it. I'm telling y'all something. The Spirit of the Lord, I'm telling you, it's going to be the Holy Ghost. We're going to be, hey, this is the Holy Ghost. I know it's the Spirit of God. It's sad. Oh, I got to quit. I got so much to say. And you know our church people? They won't come to church. They won't come to church. How they going to hear what God got to say? Everybody in Israel, when God told them to build them a tabernacle, he said, build me a tabernacle in the midst of Israel. And he said, that's where I'm going to dwell at. He said, I'm going to dwell in the midst of Israel. Build me a tabernacle. I preached on Sunday when Aaron and Miriam, when they sinned against Moses, where God told them to meet him at? Meet me at the tabernacle. I'm going to talk to y'all. He passed down stuff, didn't he? People of God, you think you're going to keep passing down stuff? You think you're going to keep doing crazy and God ain't going to judge you for it? Rest on your feet. I'm done for the night. God bless you. What's that other song we learned? Play that new song. I forget the name of it. What is it? Yeah, you know, let's sing that for the Lord, please. We're going home, okay? I pray that you receive the word of the Lord. I pray that you hear the word of God. And I'm praying to God. Now, I wish I could have had church on Thursday night so I can get back into this. I want to show you some stuff because I know God is showing it to me. Body of Christ. Come on, some of us should have been a mature and grown up. I praise God for those of you that have, you done been through stuff, but you believed in God and you brought came to the place that you're in right now. I thank God for you. But you know, the enemy, he'll try to come in and he'll try to discourage you by using other leaders that won't listen to God. They listen to their own way of thinking. And I pray God, that the word of God that we're preaching, I'm praying that you see the life of it from the word of God. We got to stop killing one another and fighting and warring against one another. I pray that you will study the scripture and seek the word of God. I pray that you will be all God wants you to be. I tell you that God's going to fulfill what he said he's going to fulfill in your life. Amen. Come on, lift your hands towards him.